All right, we should be live now. Thank you to everyone who's watching now or in the future. This is the What Do I Know About Actual Play series of videos where I am running games online. I have the What Do I Know About What Do I Know Games and Geekdom blog. My name is Jared Rasher. We are currently playing Shadow of the Demon Lord. We're going to be playing 11 sessions in total. This is our sixth session, and we're going to jump straight to player introductions. So we will start with Steve. Who are you and who are you playing?
I am Steve, and I am probably the gamer that Jared's been putting up with the longest, with the most shenanigans been pulled. Yes. I am playing the resident heal bot, Abigail Tuller. And sort of semi-reformed now, apparently likes to kill things with fire, prostitute, and in charge of people, apparently. yeah, that's kind of what she does now. Although she feels really bad about that right now.
Oh, yeah. Sometimes you feel bad about the things you're good at.
Yeah, you do feel really bad about the things you're good at. She had to take a little bit of time off last session. So, yeah, other than that, I think that covers it.
All right. Ryan, why don't you introduce yourself and who you are playing?
I'm Ryan. I've known Jared for a while now and Steve for a while and everybody else for about six sessions. I'm playing Widow's Cry. He's an elf. He's a magician spellbinder. And over the course of his long life, he's been a soldier, a scholar of magic, a scholar of war, a painter, a bandit, a burglar, a treasure hunter, a gambler, a hunter, a tracker, and an apothecary.
And a midnight toker.
Yes. He is looking for trying to gain new experiences in these strange mortal lands, which sometimes leads to problems. He's all, like, for example, he's currently carrying a book that already killed my first character in downtime. So we'll see how that ends up.
Indeed.
This is going to end well.
Mike, why don't you tell people where they can find you on the internet and then who you're playing?
Sure. I have a Twitter account at MikeMiler2, and you can find a bunch of free stuff at www.mikemiler.com. Including links to three print adventures that just went out this week for Mists of Akuma, which is like a Eastern fantasy noir steampunk campaign setting for D&D 5e. I'm in the middle of laying out for Shadow of the Demon Lord as well. I actually got about halfway just before this game started.
Nice. And
yeah. It's actually cool because Rob uses really small stat block formats. Like he got me one that was all like the headings and stuff and indentations and text size. Mm-hmm. It's really tiny. So like I've been shrinking my page count as I go into the monsters. So like there's this one page with the stats for the adult void dragon, it's named and everything. And then there are three dragon images just surrounding it. I'm really excited now that I'm starting to get to like the more stats heavy part of the book because it's gonna be easier. But yeah. The three adventures just came out this week. They're all great. You can get them print and the previews are huge so you can read the whole thing. But I am playing Fringe. Fringe is a delightfully insane changeling. And she's a rogue, but she fancies taking one of those chicken huts from one of the witches nearby. And that's like her whole thing. She knows other stuff that's going on, but like she's only gotten insanity of six, but I decided she's further off the rocker than that.
And, yeah.
Yes. While I was not present, I did watch the last session, and oh dear lord.
She just shambled around. The shadows chasing her like every time.
Yeah.
That last point. Okay. And Mr. Hobbs, why don't you tell people where they can find you and who you are playing?
I'm Jason Hobbs, the host of the podcast Hobbs and Friends of the OSR. You can find me usually on Google+ at Jason Hobbs or at Twitter at Hobbs Indeed. I'm playing a guy named Kane Smith, sometimes Smythe, just because I forget. he's gone from a criminal saboteur to a paladin, being an acolyte of the new god. So he's changed quite a bit, and we're just barely half through, so it'll be interesting to see what happens.
All right. So with all of that set, let's do our quick recap for what happened last session. The party was reunited with Kane, who brought some information about corrupt nobles recently moved to the province. Widow's Cry got them invited to an event at the estate. The former Sir Clendon, who this party has ruined his career twice, was one of the house guards, and he confided in them that something bad was happening. He didn't feel good about the place. Fringe separated from the party and wandered around the mansion looking for evidence of these chicken huts that the witches have far away from here on the other side of the province. The rest of the party made a slight slip up when they were investigating and got locked in a room with a noble who was possessed by a demon. They fought a vomit demon, and they survived that. Eventually, Fringe found the Apocalypticon, the book that destroyed Teapot much earlier on, and also the remnants of Teapot's spirit, and Fringe ran around the hallways, much like Benny Hill, running away from a shadow. The rest of the party found a torture dungeon and killed a cultist that was down there, and then found a back door into the same office that Fringe originally found. The book, the party also found a book of notes from the cultist in the torture dungeon, which has a list of nobles that were intentionally possessed by the Brotherhood of Shadows, which is the name of the cult, which they know now. Widow's Cry,
Inquisition.
Yes. Widow's Cry merged with Teapot briefly in order to secure the key to the Apocalypticon and leave the estate unharmed, and then Teapot's spirit went screaming into the void. Clendon went to go set up a meeting with the Inquisition about their evidence, and the party headed back to Abigail's safe house to wait out the night and rest and recover. And in the meantime, anybody that wanted to buy anything could do so on their way home.
I also, before I forget again, I'm going to set a record for the earliest mention of this in any of our podcast or any of our casts so far.
Oh, yes.
This is R-rated. There's swearing and the like. I mean, Seriously, there's vomit demons.
Yes.
To go downhill from there.
Exactly. There is adult content in this game. Please be warned. We'll say this now instead of an hour into the session when adult content has already filtered into the game.
And when the big scary demon fails to damage us, I'm sure Jared will profusely use the word fuck.
Yes. This may happen.
Hey, if Teapot was still alive, we would have the horrid defecation or whatever that spell is called all the time.
That is true.
Oh God.
Oh man. So
tell me, are there like rudimentary bombs or dynamite, anything like that I can get my hands on? I don't know the level of tech. I don't know. I assume it's very, very medieval, but like there are alchemists. They make.
Well, there's. It's actually the more civilized the region you get to, the more steampunkish the setting is.
Mm-hmm.
But
I mean, there are limited firearms, so I would expect at least like smoke bombs and things like that. But
well, I'm asking if I can get grenades, I want to buy some grenades.
Oh, God.
Yes.
Fringe with grenades
is better than Fringe having explosives.
That's terrifying.
There's also a potion of invisibility I'm looking at here. I mean, what's the availability we should be looking at for things we are able to buy right now?
Well, if it's in the equipment chapter, you can find it.
Excellent.
Especially even if it says exotic?
What's that?
Even exotic? If it says
exotic?
Yes.
potions right. And stuff fall under the equipment chapter, and there are exotic potions.
Yes, I know. Hey, it's my earliest GM fail.
yeah.
I wouldn't call this a fail.
Oh.
A fail would be like, yes, Fringe, you look in your pocket and find 10 rolls of dynamite and 30 invisibility potions.
Okay. So, exotic communities with a population of 10,000 or more. So yes, you would be able to find that.
Nice. Okay.
Why is reload in chapter 2? As opposed to also mentioned with the equipment.
I don't know. Why are the crew stats in Rogue Trader in the ship compartment area?
Because they're just equipment.
So yes, basically if you are inside the city, you can find just about anything, because the city is just beyond the threshold where you can find some neat stuff.
All right. So no dynamite though.
There might be some in a supplemental book, but I'm going to say it's not readily available. Okay. If it is, because I only have the core book and I don't want to
feelers for dynamite, and if rules for them arrive, then that's how we'll do it.
Yeah. All right. So all of you made it back to the safe house. You made whatever purchases you wanted to make. You got a good night's rest. Sometime before most of you got up, Vigdis seems to have gotten up and wandered out, most likely looking for Abby, because, you know, it's his job to keep Abby safe, and he's gone a whole day without seeing her. So Vigdis goes out to find Abby. Most of you probably wake up as Vigdis is, you know, stalking out, because it's Vigdis, and I imagine him moving in this apartment is enough to wake up half the people in the apartment. And about half hour after he leaves, Abby comes back. So now all of you are awake, rested. Abby is back, and Vigdis is wandering the city.
Oh, that's a bad sign.
So, at this point, what would you guys like to do?
I think we're headed towards finding the Inquisition so we can turn in this evidence against House Mallardon. Is that correct?
Yeah, well, you sent Clendon to go set up the meeting. So if you check one of the drop boxes, he may have left a message for you saying, meet us here for this meeting.
Yeah, let's do that.
Okay. So you head to one of the drop boxes that you guys have set up. And I love the fact that you guys are paranoid enough to have drop boxes and safe houses, and you did this completely on your own. This is great. So you check one of the drop boxes. You do have a message from the former Sir Clendon. And interestingly enough, the meeting place that they have specified is the Church of the Radiant Blood of the Martyr, because that seems to be a good neutral ground for church meetings.
It's not around neutral. It's a place they tried to kill us.
So he's basically saying,
I have to agree with our feather-haired friend.
It was just a conditional attempted murder. It wasn't.
Conditional attempted murder is still attempted murder.
But the people who tried to kill you are dead now. So, I mean, it's safe house. It's almost better than a safe house, probably, really.
Yeah, I mean, people don't try and kill you twice in the same spot. So, yes, at noon, you have a meeting set up with the Inquisition. So what would you like to do to prepare for that? Or are you just going to, you know, get dressed and head to church at noon?
Do you want to go in a little early? We can talk to Father Stone and, you know, actually we could be ready instead of them being ready.
I'd like to hire mercenaries.
I don't.
Okay.
I'm kidding. That gives me a brilliant idea.
I don't think
happy now, want... Abby. You gave friend an idea.
No. That's a bad.
Oh, I can buy a lot of dogs. Excellent.
Oh, God.
Oh, man. Okay. So, yes. Anything other than contemplating buying dogs that's going to go on before showing up, say, at 11 instead of noon.
Widow's Cry is not showing up early because no one except him would appreciate the talking to Father Stone that he has to do. So, certainly not Father Stone.
Okay. So Widow's Cry is going to, like, hang out outside until noon while everyone else goes in.
Given that it's the Inquisition... And that, yeah, Father Stone. Yeah. And Abby knows a lot about Father Stone. It probably wouldn't be a bad idea for Abby to say hello to Father Stone early. I actually think Kane's right.
Okay.
You sound surprised.
Given we set this up that Abby doesn't quite trust Kane, yes, I am a little bit.
Oh, man. All right. So,
I think we probably should go there a little early to make sure that we're not ambushed. Absolutely.
All right. So,
we don't have another flaming pot to throw me in.
If you guys don't mind, then we can skip ahead to 11, where everyone except Widow's Cry is already going into the church. What's Widow's Cry doing while they are going into the church?
He's going to not do anything. He's going to stand outside, let birds collect on his shoulders, and largely confuse people.
So basically, Widow's Cry is like standing out in the street across from the church doing performance art.
Do you need a hat at your feet so you can collect gold coins to hand out later?
Dance when no one's looking, stop when they look.
No, he has gold coins that he hands out to other people. That's how he's different.
Yes, but those never mind.
All right, so is Fringe going into the church with everyone else?
She looks like a witch right now, so she, I don't know, I mean, like, she's pretty crazy. Let's roll and see whether or not she thinks that the Inquisition is going to care that she looks like a fucking witch.
So, okay.
She will go in.
Okay. So, Abigail, Kane, and Fringe go into the church about an hour before the Inquisition is supposed to get there, and since you're in a big city, there are timepieces, so it is possible to, you know, actually time things on the hour as we, you know, establish the technology level. It's not like out in the wilderness where you may not have watches, but in a town, there actually are some means of measuring this more accurately. So you walk into the church, and you see Father Stone is out arranging things in the church. He's, you know, putting up different tapestries for the time of year. And he sees all of you walk in and goes, "So I've heard you have another meeting coming up."
Yeah, no, we don't have anybody trying to kill us this time, do we?
No. No one is trying to kill you. Everything is perfectly all right. It is the Inquisition, but they have not pre-established any kind of trap or situation that would be harmful to you. Sorry about that last time.
I was wondering, is Clendon going to be with them as well, or with us, or?
You're not sure. He set up the meeting, so you're not sure if he's coming with them or if he's coming independently.
Okay.
He just kind of wanted to get out of there and looked up some of his contacts to talk to them. So Father Stone goes, "What exactly is this meeting about?"
"We have evidence against House Mallardon to show to prove their corruption."
"Ah, yes, I've wondered about a great many of the nobles that came in here when the capital fell. It seems like that was a potential for many dangerous things to happen, and everything just seems to be collapsing ever since that happened."
"Yeah.
Very disconcerting."
"Well, if here's a question. Would Kane and company have told Abby kind of a Cliff's Notes version of what happened?"
I know. Because you woke up and then it's 11 now, so you had several hours in between.
"Would you guys have told me kind of like some of the details that they were doing some of that?"
"Yeah, show you the evidence and all that, sure."
"Okay.
Also, if you look at it again, give me another intellect test with a boon, because you have a little bit more time to look at the entries and try and make sense out of them."
"Who do you want to roll, I guess?"
Whoever was looking at it. I mean, if you have multiple people look at it, they can make a check.
I'm sure that was the main topic of conversation as we waited, so.
What, the torture book?
No.
Oh, the
evidence.
Oh, the evidence. All right. I'll take the.
I got a 19.
Okay.
And I'll tie with that.
So. All right. So as the two of you were poring over these entries this morning, you know, glancing at it last night, you saw obviously he's got his notes on who he was torturing and, you know, how long they could take various torture for. But then there was a section on after they tortured them for a while, they would possess them with demons. And you noticed that there were several key nobles in the city that they were having possessed with demons. Now that you look at it in more depth, you realize that they're, besides just randomly picking up some nobles that they had possessed with demons to make their position a little stronger in the city, there is a whole section that goes into them finding out that that Sirigus was Prince Horus's bastard child, and them trying to invite him to a party and not being able to get him there, and then finding out that he would be traveling through the region where you guys were at in your village and setting up that entire situation to ambush him and infuse him with a demon.
Lovely.
Oh, crap. Does it indicate that he was they were successful?
It doesn't specifically say, but it does mention that they couldn't get him invited to a party and that they set up that entire situation in your village in order to rectify the fact that he would not show up at any parties.
Oh, poop.
So, yes, your information that you're about to turn over to the Inquisition doesn't just implicate a bunch of nobles. It also implicates the warden of the province who is currently in power since no one has seen Prince Horus for a while. There was also a note mentioning that if they could get Sirigus, they were hoping that Sirigus could potentially take over Prince Horus.
Oh dear.
So your conspiracy goes up pretty high in this notebook. So does this change any of your planning now?
Fringe still plans to try to convince everybody to go to that town up north so we can go up river faster to the forest where the chicken tots are.
I'm not shocked.
Yeah.
I'm not sure it does change anything as far as Kane's concerned. If they are corrupted, then, I mean, we're trying to stop this troll song thing, right? So mm-hmm. We'd have to have them stopped, I guess, if they are. Or maybe it just turns into trying to find Prince Horus ourselves. Or
yes, it would be great if you had a lead on Prince Horus's location.
It would. Question.
Yes.
Does this have any notes on Abby's favorite noble?
No. He is not mentioned as a target. There's no mention of him showing up at any of these parties or any of that nature.
Good.
You don't have anything that indicates that he was part of this in any way.
Yay! There's one boon on that.
Fringe will absentmindedly say that she knows where Prince Horus is as she like picks at her fingers.
So does anyone act on Fringe piping up saying that she knows where Prince Horus is?
We're not sure where to take that information or how to take it.
It's Fringe.
That's what I'm saying.
At the same time, I'm guessing that Prince Horus is in a chicken hut.
She nods.
Oh, God. Oh, man.
You know what? We'll pick up a chicken hut on the way back from the Lake of Sighs.
That is in the same direction.
See? See? We can compromise here, Fringe. Does that sound good to you?
Yes. Away. let's go.
We got a couple of other errands to do in the meantime, but we've got to get some other things done.
I will get the dog chariots ready. And then she disappears.
Oh dear.
So since Abby and Kane were looking at the nobles notebook this morning, Did Widow's Cry do any reading in the Apocalypticon?
No.
Not making it your implement, because we were careful to look that you can read the book without making it your implement.
Okay, fine. Yes.
So sometime this morning when you guys were doing this research, you hear this young woman's voice scream.
Hey, I remember that sound.
Opens the book.
Last time I heard that sound, Teapot was around.
So, Widow's Cry, give me an intellect test to see if you've picked up anything useful just in the few hours that you were looking through this book.
Or if you've gotten any more corruption.
That would be a 17.
All right. So with a 17, just paging through the book, since you were specifically looking for useful information for the immediate future, obviously you couldn't just whip it up now, but you're pretty sure with the information in the Apocalypticon, you might be able to set up with the information that the witches gave you between this book and the information the witches gave you. Given enough time, you could probably set up the ritual to redirect the troll spell to Diabolus. Whether you wish to share this or not is up to you.
Have I run into any other elves in the city?
Not in the city, not recently, no. The crackdown that that Warden Regis did in the city kind of has made a lot of people that aren't usual dwellers in the city, like elves, kind of uncomfortable.
How far from this lake of size is the bridge? Sorry, I know you gave us a map, but my brain is not functional.
That's okay. Actually, the bridge is... Dun, dun, ba, 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 ba. Just for comparison's sake, the bridge is less than a week from Holdfast. Lake of Size is to the north, kind of in the middle of the province. So not quite on the opposite end of the province, but not in the same direction.
Are you talking the bridge to the east over Deeping's Gorge?
Yes.
Okay.
I need to go to the bridge.
Okay. Is
it hot at the bridge? Oh, no, I'm sorry. I'm out getting things for me.
So what is the deal with the bridge? Is this the place where you want us to slaughter all the village?
No. That needs to be done over on the other side of the kingdom. No, I need to speak to somebody at the bridge.
You need to speak to somebody at the bridge.
Okay, so that's what you got there. This was all of our flashback to what we were doing this morning. So now you're standing outside the church watching them, contemplating that you need to go to the bridge. Everybody's inside the thing, and Fringe has said that she knows where Prince Horus is, and it turned into another witch's chicken hut discussion. And
then she went off to get the dog.
As they do. Carrots.
Okay. So Fringe left to go buy dogs.
Dogs, sleds, and bags of fat.
Okay. So Fringe will be doing that while you have a meeting with the Inquisitor. All right. That's so Father
probably
Stone.
Probably for the best. So it's Cain and Abby Abigail. And
well,
is Widow's Cry going to come in during the meeting?
For the meeting, yes.
Okay.
So a little bit before the meeting, Father Stone comes up with some tea and goes, would you like some... Oh, your friend that looks like the crazy witch disappeared. Will she be coming back in time for tea?
Hard telling.
Good question. We'll have another crazy friend in here in a few minutes. So
Father Stone leaves the tea out for you. I'll be back in my room if you need me. And good luck. And he excuses himself. Widow's Cry, a few minutes later, you will see three people plus the former Sir Clendon walking into the front of the church.
I will follow them.
Okay.
Just before they come in, because of the last experience we've had here, I'm going to cast Magic Acorns. Just before they come into the building, because I don't trust them.
Okay. All right. So you cast that, and you have that prepared as they walk into the building. Clendon walks in, and Clendon looks over, and he kind of nods at Kane because he's not quite as sure about Abigail, especially since she wasn't there last night.
Hey, I went peaceful the last time I talked. I did anything with him.
And Clendon looks over. He kind of takes Kane aside. He said, they still, because of my reputation, didn't want to speak to me, but apparently I had just enough clout that they gave me enough time to say that you had something really important. And he kind of excuses himself and stands over by the entrance as Widow's Cry walks in and shakes his head as Widow's Cry walks in.
I'll stand on the opposite side of the entrance from him.
Okay. Nobody's closing this entrance up today.
That's right.
That's a good thing.
So, right,
how many Inquisitors are here?
Three. So one of them.
Okay.
One of them looks at Kane and says, "We are having this meeting because Clendon still has some friends, and you are a paladin in good standing with the Church of the New God. However, you do keep strange company, and odd things have happened recently. We need to find out what exactly is going on. You say you have some sort of information about cult activity."
That's correct. I guess we have the journal, and then is that it, or we have other things? I can't remember, I guess.
Depends on whether you want to turn the Apocalypticon over to the Inquisition or not.
Well, I'm not involved with that thing.
I would provide the journal, and I would definitely tell them about the torture chamber and everything below that home.
Yeah, so that's what we'll do, and you know, maybe go into the they draw in people through their orgastic parties and such. So,
Widow's Cry will give a academic breakdown of their successes and failures in the torture area.
So the Inquisitors kind of look at Widow's Cry, and like the jaw on one of them just keeps getting lower the more specific Widow's Cry gets with things worked in there and what exactly they were doing and their success rates. And this is going to play out in a special manner when we make this check, because you now actually, if you succeed, are going to get a better result, but you get a bane because they're worried about Widow's Cry, but the details he provides, if they are on your side, they're really sure that you guys know there's a cult.
Oh, dear.
But that bane, though, may be canceled out because I provide a boon in social settings.
Yes, this is true. So,
I am going to go with my prayer that'll allow me to use when they do a challenge roll and use triggered action to give them a boon to cancel out that bane.
All right.
I'm like, please, let's not have this be a bad thing.
So here's my, he looks at you, and you know, they listen to Widow's Cry's description and get horribly aghast at that. And then he stops.
Oh, they're in the position. They're taking notes.
Yes, they are.
Well, these are more the guys that go in and set people on fire and stab people. Not the people that, that's in a different part of the hierarchy. But these guys are, they touch the notebook and they go, "We will look through this thoroughly, but is there something, can you summarize what you have read so far, or is there anything you want to disclose about anything that you have seen before we take this back and examine it?"
A number of nobility are specifically mentioned as volunteering for possession.
Well, maybe not volunteering. Volunteering
well, like, please don't touch me with that hot poker anymore.
Yes, that's the type of volunteering we're talking about.
Yes, but so they hear that and they go, "This may be what we need to get the Inquisition away from all of this infighting between the various factions of the church in this city now and focus on some really good old fashioned defeating cultists like we would like in the past. There, nothing better than if we could find a good noble house to make the villain of the entire city and burn it to the ground. And you see this like this big smile crosses his face as he's saying
And then of course Abby's just kind of raising her hand. It's like you do realize not a member of the church, not an enemy here, right?
Yes, and he pulls out a piece of paper and unfolds it because they have the standard disclaimer. Members of the old faith, while incorrect in their beliefs, are not direct enemies of our faith and are only targeted if their activities seem as if they are in line with worshiping devils or demons. And then he folds it back up and puts it back in his pocket.
But you let that guy in here.
Face palms, but I'm going to have to take that as nice as you it can get here. The last time I dealt with somebody with any kind of inquisition I've been tried to be burned before, so
it's, yeah, literally, yes.
Widow's Cry will point towards the back room, and yet you let him in here.
Who was that now?
Hey, Jip, he's a nice guy. Let him be.
Wait, what?
Father Devil Spawn.
There is a Devil Spawn? What? Wait, let the strange fey creature speak. And then he pulls out the disclaimer and turns to the other side. And we would not want any display of reticence among a member of a practitioner of the old faith to appear as if they are aiding worshippers of devils and or demons and therefore come under the scrutiny of the Inquisition. Then he pulls it back up and back in the pocket. So, yes, Devil Spawn fey creature.
Old dude in the robes.
The priest. He is a devil spawn.
That's what his spine says.
Ah, a cambion in our church. We will definitely investigate this. Thank you. And he pats you on the shoulder. So now we're throwing Father Stone under the bus. Your total so far to see how seriously they're going to take this investigation and invest in this. You're going to get your boon from him being an elf. You're going to get your boon from Abby's thing. You have a bane from how how terrible the description was and how disturbed they were by it. And you're going to get a bane just because it is a major undertaking in everything that's going on. So right now, it looks like whoever makes your social check on these guys is just going to be making a flat roll.
Let me check something real quick. Because it could be interesting. Yep, never mind.
Okay. So I'd like to make the final push.
Challenges as attacks. So I was checking to see if battle prowess would let me roll my social attack twice and take the better, but it says specifically attacks with a weapon.
Yeah. So. I'm going to yell a battle cry before I explain the situation to them.
Hey, it was worth a shot.
Oh, I know. So who would like to make the final check to convince them?
Okay, Widow's Cry, you can have this one.
15.
All right. So they think this is a worthy undertaking for the Inquisition. They're going to try and rally all of the various groups that have been basically covering the asses of various church members in the city to rally around rooting out these nobles and burning their houses to the ground. And then they go, and thank you once again, fey creature. And they pat you on the shoulder and they walk into the into the room and
kill Father Stone.
The three of them like throw Father Stone out in front of the altar and pull the back of his robes down and see the signs along his spine. And they go, you have much to answer for, priest. And he looks at your entire group, especially Cain. And he just has this look of horrid betrayal on his face. Like, he doesn't say anything, but you just see this depth of despair on his face as he looks over all of you when this happens.
You should not have volunteered your house to be a place for our destruction.
So, and with that, I'm going to, and this is just a meta explanation for anybody that cares, but Widow's Cry made a really good case from his point of view for why he doesn't trust Father Stone and he hasn't been with you guys this whole time. Like, if someone else had done this for the express purpose of, you know, getting the Inquisition on your side, I might have thrown out corruption, but I actually think Widow's Cry legitimately being a fairly new member here and finding out that he's a Cambion and that he did kind of lie to the party, except for Kane, because he didn't volunteer that Kane was actually, he was the one that sent Kane on his side mission. I'm not going to give Widow's Cry corruption over that, but I might have if somebody else had done it.
I'm more than willing to take it if whatever.
As a side note, Abby wants to know where Father Stone gets taken.
That they're just going to take him back to their offices to have a discussion with him to find out what he might have done.
Where is he going to end up being tortured? That's the question.
Well, we have offices at the cathedral, and he will be treated with the respect of a member of the clergy who has been hiding secrets from the church, and as would be treated.
All right. Duly noted.
You know what? Honestly, Widow's Cry, if you are willing to take the point of corruption, I think I might do that.
Absolutely.
Just because that was such a gut punch moment there for Father Stone.
He was clearly working with them. Yeah, Widow's Cry has no sadness about the fact that he tried, he was willing to work with people who were going to kill us and then chickened out the last minute per the testimony of the people who tried to kill us.
Yes. So I am just also going to frame the clarification things. You guys didn't mention that Warden Regan might have been been possessed by this cult, and they will find that out in that journal. So they're going to take action. You don't know exactly how they're going to take action with that information. Like, in other words, they didn't seem like they had any problem going after all these nobles. That might be a different matter, and you're not sure how that's going to shake out because you didn't bring that up in the conversation.
I do have one more question.
Yes.
I wasn't actually here. What is a Cambion? Is it some kind of demon or something? Or
yeah, it's essentially what D&D would call a tiefling.
Okay.
So he has devil blood in his family.
So I think Kane is going to see if he can talk on his behalf if there's some sort of trial or something.
Okay, yeah. So you mentioned to the Inquisition that they're like, so you wish to speak on his behalf when if we find that there are any charges that need to be leveled against a being that has devil blood in them and has been hiding in the church and lying to us. If we find that we need to level charges against him, we will gladly take your
testimony
or whatever into account. Thank you for volunteering, good paladin.
Yep. That's the best possible. If he does come out of it okay, then it's all taken care of. He doesn't have to worry about it anymore.
Exactly.
So they drag him off. They leave the church. They have the notebook. What would you guys like to do now? And also, Fringe, how many dogs do you buy?
Well, so here's her plan. She wants to buy a flat-bottomed sled with rails, and then get bags of fat, and then have the dogs in front of her like it's a dog sled. But she'll put the fat bags, like, on the brims, I guess, the front of the rails.
and cut like small holes in them or something so that like they grease the rails and it's able to pull it over land.
Okay.
And I guess I'll get them some horses.
Okay. Did you guys buy horses last time you guys went to Overland?
We did, yes.
So yeah. You guys still got horses, so I don't have to get your horses?
I guess so. Would we still have the horses from then?
It's only been a year ago. Unless you guys would have sold off your horses in the last year. Because, you even got a wagon because you needed Vigdis to ride in the wagon because there wasn't a horse that could handle Vigdis.
Yes, we did. We've got a horse and wagon. We could get some supplies, and we could probably go to the bridge that Widow's Cry wants to go to and just go to there. And how long would that take with horses and a wagon?
If you had mounts, it'd probably take you about 2 days.
I mean, that wouldn't be too bad, would it? Get us out of town and get us away from the insanity that is the town. Sadly, it's also Father Stone who's been betrayed by Widow's Cry, but that's another story. He doesn't know Father Stone like we do, but that's another story.
So, would you like to head to the bridge? Party?
Yeah, sure.
What was the other thing? Wasn't there something that Abby wanted?
The Lake of Sighs is on the other side of the province, and that's like 2 weeks travel.
Okay. And why does Widow's... I always want to call him Widow's Peak. Does he tell us why he wants to go to the bridge?
He said he wanted to speak with someone.
Is it about the troll song, or... Is there a reason you need us to go, or...
It is. Okay. No, I can go on my own. I can be a few days behind you.
That's fine, though. I mean, if that's what we need to do, like Abby said, it wouldn't necessarily be horrible to get out of town for a few days.
Okay. So, if you went to the bridge first, it's 2 days one direction, then 2 weeks the other direction, as opposed to, going there first and then coming back to the bridge. If you guys would like to do that.
I mean, the other option, given that we don't have Vigdis, and I mean this with no disrespect, the other option is something more that would require more subterfuge, which would be dealing with the witches of the blue hands.
Yes, which is, that's about halfway between here and the Lake of Sighs. So that's about a week away out in the claims.
Well, we can hit the bridge. I can drop off. I can have the discussion I need to have. Then we can go do that.
Yeah, do that. Then do the bridge. Then do the witches. And then do the Lake of Sighs. And hopefully pick up Vigdis in the interim.
Awesome. Anyone dislike this plan?
No.
All right. So you guys collect your horses and your cart.
And your dog's
friend shows up with the dog sled.
She's got the bloody remains of the shed that she tried to turn into a chicken hut on top of the sled.
That's horrifying, Fringe.
Oh, man.
I believe...
I am going to, because I clearly heard how Fringe wants us to work, I don't know how good an engineer Fringe is. So, Fringe, if you would like to make me an intellect challenge with one bane to see if you can get your contraption to work as a dog sled in the spring, go ahead and give me that check.
Intellect, and I will trickery it, so I got a net plus 2.
And if you want, you can spend your fortune to make sure that this works.
Do I want to spend my fortune now, though? The dog sled does sound so cool. Yeah, I'll spend my fortune. I'll just spend my fortune.
So it works. Against all logic, everyone's looking at this dog sled that should not work in the springtime over rough ground.
And with a chicken coop on it.
Yes.
and Fringe sitting on, I'm picturing Fringe sitting on top of the chicken coop.
Uh-huh. But she's inside of it, like sticking her head out.
Yeah.
Oh, dear Lord. Okay, so it looks like a tiki hut because you've probably got the mask on still.
Yeah, of course.
The cheap death mask.
Yeah, the cheap fake Inquisitor death mask, yes.
Oh, man. All right, so let's see if what interesting things happen on the way to the bridge. Hey, wow. One interesting good thing happens and one interesting bad thing happens. That's handy.
Interesting good and interesting bad.
So if you have, mark off 2 days worth of any provisions you might have.
All right. Ding, ding.
So the potentially positive thing that you have going on is that on your way to, wow, this is actually something happening in the group. On your way to there, you notice animals appearing and doing strange things that they don't normally do.
Like strange things like throwing tea parties or strange things like walking on hind legs.
Like you see like birds flying overhead and not in bee patterns, but like in these weird intricate signs of different types that they wouldn't normally fly in. So any one person can attempt an intellect challenge to interpret what's going on with them.
That would be, I've got nature, so I will take that one, and that would be a 21.
All right, so with a 21, you're reading this as a sign of the future, like the gods and various spirits are specifically trying to tell you the right path to take from this point on. So for the rest of this session, as long as you phrase this as, oh, I shouldn't have done this way, I should have done it this way, you get a boon on any test that you attempt.
Run that by me again.
So basically, it's just that you can read what these guys are doing to tell you the right path. You know, basically, you got to do like a major augury from this thing.
Okay.
So everybody, as long, I mean, it's more just a narrative thing, but like you get a boon basically saying, oh no, I should do it this way instead of this way, and then you get a boon to anything that you're rolling. Everybody, as long as Abby is there to interpret what you should be doing, you get a boon on this. And now for the potentially bad thing that happened on your trip. Okay. So you are about a day away from the bridge. It's nightfall. How would you guys set up camp here?
I'd circle the wagon and... Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
And watch, normally. I mean, I was a warrior for a while, right? So
all the dogs are tied up here.
I will use my knowledge as a former bandit to, you know, help arrange the camp to be less noticeable to other bandits.
Nice. Okay, so I'm assuming everyone is going to take a watch.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
Everyone, give me a D6 roll and let me know who gets the lowest.
5.
4.
2.
What's
that?
5.
Fringe, you and I roll off. I got a 6 on my second.
I got a 5 on my second.
All right. So Fringe is the one watching the camp as the potential danger happens.
Oh, well, that's why is that not a surprise?
So, Fringe, let's see, Widow's Cry did the helping to set up the camp and was a former bandit, so knows how to do this. So I will translate that into a boon for Widow's Cry to make your perception test.
Okay. I have shadow sight. Does that matter?
Yes. Give yourself another boon.
So I have 2 boon.
Yes.
It's a perception check. I got +2, +2 boon.
2d6, boom, perception, watch. 28.
Okay. So, you notice around the outside of the camp, all of a sudden, like, the dogs kind of, like, perk up and start sniffing around, and your head whips around to that direction, and most of the people from the firelight here probably wouldn't be able to see this, but you see a large humanoid, like, at least as big as Vygdis, and instead of a human head, it has a bear's head, and it is currently carrying a battle axe in its hands, and it's wearing like this grubby mismatched group of like leathers and stuff like that. And it looked like it was getting ready to sneak into camp to do something nefarious with that axe, mm-hmm. but you look straight at it and it looks at you.
Is it within short range?
It makes a nasty growl, yes. And for purposes of this, we're going to basically, there's more or less two areas. There's going to be inside the inside where you have the wagon circled, and then outside.
Well, hold on.
You are both inside that right now.
I have the subterfuge roguery trickery, and I will attempt that on this thing.
Okay. And
I guess I make an intellect attack roll against it.
Okay.
And it has to be able to understand what I say. So let me check my languages real quick. I doubt it speaks the vile speech.
You do.
Oh, I do. But I don't know if it does. Where the hell? Where did I put my languages at? So I guess I use the common tongue and hope that it speaks the common tongue.
Okay.
And yeah, intellect attack roll. The boon. So plus 2, plus 1d6. Intellect versus bear man. 21.
And what ability is that going against?
Using an intellect of one creature within short range, so it's intellect score.
Okay. So yeah, you that takes effect. What do you do to it?
Well, on a success, the target becomes charmed for one round or until I attack it.
Okay. It's hard to explain this, but you get the feeling there is this grin on this bear's face as it looks at you, and it seems very friendly towards you, and goes, I'm going to sneak in and cut all of their heads off. Is that okay?
I yell very loudly, no! Fuck off! That's it. She's not going to do any more than that. She's going to just loudly yell for him to fuck off, and then go back to whatever crazy shit, trying to stitch two dogs together or whatever it is she's doing.
So the funny thing is, it actually looks dejected when you say that, and it looks at you and it goes, well, I wasn't going to cut your head off. I'll be quiet about it. And it turns back to the camp. So we're going to start combat. This thing is not interested in killing Fringe at all. But I'm going to say that since Fringe took the time to yell fuck off extremely loud, all of you will be awake in your tents, but you aren't necessarily up, you know, and going when this starts. So we're going to start with a fast turn. What is everyone doing? And would you like to take a fast turn?
Slow.
Slow turn, I think.
We've got to get up and out of the tents.
Slow. Sorry.
Oh. So, the only person that the bugbear could reach... Oh, sorry. The only person that the bear-headed creature that you don't know anything about could reach with a fast turn is the person that he's not going to kill, because he really likes Fringe. So, he is also going to take a slow turn. So, now we will go to slow turns. Who would like to take a slow turn?
Everybody! So, Abby's going to get up and... So, can she get up and out of her tent?
You could get up and out of your tent, but you don't have... Unless, you know, whatever gear you would logically be sleeping with, you would have, but...
Well, outside of sleeping next to her little magic wand. She's, well, we know what she does for a living. She doesn't really sleep with any clothes on. So this has never come up in game before. So, she's so going to stand up and walk outside of the tent, and she's buck naked.
With a wand.
With a wand. With a magic wand.
Okay. So what does Abby want to do with that wand now that she's out there like that?
Can she see, well, does she have any action left?
Let's see. Standing up, that would be moving, and you grabbed your... No. So yeah, you basically just... You are as equipped as you can be and outside your tent.
And she sees horrible creature, right?
Yes, you see a creature at least as big as Vignus with a bear's head and an axe.
Well, shit.
So, who else would like to go?
I'll come out of my tent with my shield and sword.
Okay. So, Kane gears up and gets up and walks out, so that will be your turn.
I'm assuming that doesn't include putting on armor, but I don't know, I guess.
Yeah, the armor would take a little bit too long to do that, but yeah, you could grab your sword and shield on a slow turn and walk out. Widow's Cry?
Going to grab the bow and use a zero level to imbue it as a spellbinder.
Okay.
And not leave my tent.
Okay, that's what I figured. So you grab the bow, cast the spell, stay in the tent. Gotcha. Okay, so for its slow turn, it really likes impressive displays of blood. So I think it's going to attempt to kill Kane first.
Okay.
And the bugbear looks over its shoulder to Fringe and goes, "I'm just going to cut that one's head up. It's okay. Don't worry. I'll try not to make too much of a mess."
I told you to fuck off.
I know. It's really cute when you say that.
Don't make me get up.
Oh, man. So it is going to walk over to you. And so that is... Okay. So that is with two boons. It attacks... Oh, wow. So that is a 27 against Kane.
Ow.
I didn't hear what you said.
27 to hit.
Okay. That'll hit, I'm sure. Wouldn't matter if I had armor or not.
Yeah.
Oh, crap. That is terrible. So it manages to hit you and grab you automatically because it rolled that high over 20. I'm assuming that's more than 5 than it needed to hit you.
Yep.
So it gets an automatic grab on you as well as hitting you, and then it chunks you with the axe. So, grab on attack roll 20 plus, grab target. Okay, that's terrible. Okay, so that's 4, 5, 6 dice. Sorry, I am so sorry about this. Okay. So that is 20 points of damage to Kane.
All right.
Ow!
A nasty chop. I always like to grab people before I chop them with my axe.
So I am assuming that Kane is not incapacitated by this.
No.
That is good. Because if Kane were incapacitated by this, that would be bad.
Next time, maybe.
All right. So you are still grabbed unless you spend an action to get ungrabbed. And that is the bugbear's turn.
Well, I will shoot it now because...
Oh, sorry.
Well, I wasn't going to until it attacked somebody, and now it attacked somebody. So.
Gotcha. Okay. So, Fringe?
I'll just shoot it with... How many bullets I got left?
All of the bullets.
Well, I got 12 bullets. Are you worth a bullet? Yeah. Okay, so I'll shoot a bullet at it.
Okay.
And I'll use my trickery business, and I'll get 2d6 extra if I hit now this, because nice. Rogue. 1d20 plus 1d6 plus 2, I think. 2 agility. Yeah. 26. So I also get... do I exceed his AC by 5?
His defense? Yes.
Okay, so I get to take another point. Or another turn before the end of the round, so I'll take another turn to attack him again.
Nice.
Use the other pistol. And I'll use trickery, which I can use twice around now. So, ha! 14, is that a hit?
Yes.
Okay, so I'll shoot him with two pistols. 14
by one, sorry.
Oh, 14 is by one? Oh, man, that's too bad. All right.
Hold on.
I should have done it by saying I should have done it this way.
And add your boon to that check.
Does Abby have a triggered action?
I do have a triggered action for prayer.
Nice.
So
I rolled a one on my boon, which is just enough to hit.
I'm like, wait a minute. And actually for the combat one, it's actually two boons now. Nice. So divine strike. So nice. Yeah.
All right. So you hit with both attacks. What did you do to it?
Bullet one does, they both deal 15 points of damage.
Nice.
That is a lot of damage.
Yeah. The two shots like tear through the bearish hide of the large humanoid, and it's bleeding profusely. It doesn't look like it's ready to collapse, but it does look like it's been seriously injured.
So I'll take a fast turn to shoot with my hand crossbow, and I'll be like, fuck off!
All right, so that is round one. Round two, who would like to take a fast turn?
Abby would like to take a fast turn.
Okay.
And I would like to use my new trick.
Okay.
And I'm going to tell this frightening bear creature to kneel. Yay! Okay. And I even got the right kind of success. 22 on my die roll. Cower is the spell that I cast.
Okay.
One creature within medium range. I made an intellect attack roll.
All right.
And against the target's will. On a success, the target becomes immobilized for 1 minute. When immobilized this way, this target is also frightened for 1 minute.
Nice.
Now, once for round one, the target takes damage. It can make a will challenge to remove this action. However, on an attack roll of 20 plus, the target also falls prone and cannot stand up while immobilized this way.
All right. So what did you get?
I got a 22.
Wow. Yeah, that is more than its will. So the funny thing about this is it doesn't immediately relinquish Kane, so it falls flat on its face.
It needs to immobilize.
So basically it does like a falling choke slam with Kane.
But at least Kane can get away now.
Yeah. So Kane, you're on the ground under its hand, but yeah, it's
You can get away. and then
is that a slow action to do that? I guess. Sorry.
Well, is that all Abby's? Everything that Abby's doing?
Unless I can use a triggered action for selfless recovery to.
Yeah, you can use that whenever. So.
I'll use that to use self. Even though it does affect up to two creatures, I will use it to give Kane heal Kane up for his healing rate.
Nice. So Kane gets back his healing rate.
Oh, okay, thank you.
Yeah. You kind of need that.
So who else would like to go?
I'll take a fast turn. I'd like to use Samuel Jackson, walk up there, and execute the bugbear on the ground.
Okay. You, let's see, it's prone.
Immobilized, defenseless.
So it has, you have two boons on to hit it.
That is a 20. I'll only deal 3d6 with this, I think. Let me double check my hand crossbow. Yeah, that's it. Oh, only 7 points of damage.
Oh.
Now, here's the question. Does he make his will challenge roll to actually get unstuck?
Does he make that on his turn or at the end of the turn?
once per round when he takes damage.
Ah, okay. So what is the DC to it?
It's a will challenge roll, so 10.
All right. So, yeah. He has been hit, so he's like, nope, nope, not laying down anymore. Sorry.
Well, Pope.
However, I'm going to roll that having been dropped to the ground and popped back up, Kane is free without having to make any actions. But you are still prone until you stand up.
Okay. You kind of went in and out there on me, but I think I got the gist of it.
Yeah, basically the bugbear from dropping down and then making its check to resist this, he let go of you in all of that, even though he is no longer prone and immobilized now because he's taking damage.
Okay.
So.
He's on his feet then, or?
No, he's still prone, so you still get the boon to hit him. It's just now he can move if he wants to.
I'm prone as well, right?
Yes.
And it takes a turn to stand up, or I mean, that's why I was going to take a slow move.
Yeah, yeah, you would just take your move to stand up, and then you're standing up, and you can stab it.
Okay.
Okay. So that's Kane's going to take a slow turn. Does Widow's Cry want to take a slow turn or a fast turn?
Slow turn.
Okay. So, I think the bugbear really wants to cut someone's head off. So I think instead of standing up, he's going to take a slow turn and just swing the axe sideways at Kane. I need to cut someone's head off.
A slow turn or a fast turn?
Or a fast turn, sorry. So, on his turn, he's just going to swing the axe, but he's got a bane now because he is on the ground. So that's those and that. Thank you, dear. So, does an 18 hit Kane?
Yep.
He does not automatically grab you this time, which is good. And oh my god, I am, you know, all of the fives and lowers that I was rolling last time, that's not what I'm doing this time.
That's cool.
So that is 17 points of damage on Kane.
Ow.
All right.
Does that incapacitate Kane? I hope not.
Nope.
Good.
Fortunately, right. Because I was.
Yeah, it's probably good that Abby healed you there.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so that's the bugbear's turn. So slow turns for anyone that would like to take a slow turn.
Widow's Peak will walk over, standing behind Kane, and say "tilt," and pour a healing potion down Kane's throat.
Okay.
What's going on?
Everybody heal Kane.
Everybody heal Kane.
Kane is sticking to Kane and like today. Jerks his shoulder up. Oh, that's too weird. Is it a pinball reference? No?
That's I didn't hear. Oh, man. Okay, so Kane, would you like to take your slow turn?
Yeah, and when can I take triggered actions?
Whenever it, sometimes there'll be a specific thing saying that it gets triggered, but if it just says you can take a triggered action and doesn't give a condition, you can do it whenever. You can just only do one of them a turn.
So I'll take a triggered action to catch my breath.
Okay.
All right, and then I will attack this dude. And he's prone, you said?
Yes.
So I have a boon?
Yes.
And I have to decide if I want. Which place I should attack him, and Abby can tell me, and I get another boon. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, basically. Yeah, if you're Abby, should I approach him this way or this way? And then if
exactly.
Yeah.
All right.
The bird.
My action can have is three boons. Is this thing almost dead or what?
It looks. It looks like if you hit it really hard, it could die in one shot, but. It might survive.
Does a 16 hit?
A 16 does hit it.
Okay. All right, so here, I'll do a Divine Smite. 2 Forceful Strike. This is 3. All right, 3d6. 10, 11, 13.
All right. It is not quite dead yet. It's looking very haggard. It's bleeding all over the place. It's kind of sluggish, but it is not dead.
Okay.
So that was the second round. So now we're going into round 3. Who would like to take fast turn?
Abby. I'll take fast turn. Yeah, I think we all will here.
All right. Whoever wants to take their first turn, go ahead and do it.
All right, Abby. Shoots him in the face.
Okay.
All right. Well,
I was gonna fucking 23. Kills this fucking thing. God damn it. Eight damage? Are you serious? Hold on. Did I exceed its defense by more than 5 with my result of 23?
Yes.
She shoots it again. Shoots the shit out of it. Ah, motherfucker dies. 16 hits. Okay, 17 total damage.
Okay, so now it is dead.
Finally. All right.
The silence that follows, what does Peter go? So, now that you're almost dead, would you like to pull our cart and kill our enemies instead of dying yourself? Oh, wait, no, you wouldn't because you're already dead.
So, all of you can make an intellect test at this moment, seeing the dead corpse of this thing.
17 plus 3, 20.
17.
Okay.
10.
7.
All right. So you're fairly certain upon looking at this thing that this is the thing that Horus came here to do was to tame this entire region from the Beastmen. This is definitely one variety of the Beastmen that had been plaguing the region for all those years before Horus tamed this region. There's still a problem, like, over towards the mountains and the forests. There's still some that run out as an incursion every once in a while. But basically half the province has been more or less clear of these things for years. So this is pretty far into the province for one of the Beastmen to have infiltrated. However, with everything that has been going on, you're probably not too surprised by that.
Probably not.
Nah.
So, given all of the fun horribleness that just happened to poor Kane, I'm going to cast moderate healing on Kane, and you're going to heal.
I'll probably be fine after tonight. I have a very good healing rate, so unless I did it incorrectly, I have a 10. So I mean, up to 27 out of 34.
The terrible thing about bugbear head takers, which is what that thing was, if they incapacitate you, they chop your head off. So in other words, if you're incapacitated, you don't make death rolls. You are dead.
Nice.
As he's going back to his tent, he's going to say, hey, Fringe, it's got a bird head. I'm betting if you attach to your house, it'll be one step closer.
It's got a bear head.
Bear head.
Oh, it's got a bear head. I'm sorry. You said owlbear. You said bugbear. I was thinking owlbear. Because owlbear. <Yeah.
laughs> She will feed that to the dogs, though.
Okay. Because there's nothing better to feed dogs than the natural beastmen meat that they crave.
Well, I mean, now they'll have a taste for beastmen. And if there's a bunch of beastmen running around here, well, all the better for us.
Exactly.
Well, wouldn't that turn the dogs into beastmen?
No. Don't be ridiculous.
Ridiculous.
Oh, dear.
It's a rumor. And I'll take a dog man chariot. It's a dog chariot. Same deal.
Oh, all right. So you get the rest of the way there. You see the span, which is a very impressive bit of engineering. It's a giant stone bridge over the gorge. There is a few little settlements nearby, and there's guard posts on the side of the thing. Widow's Cry, what exactly are you planning on doing now that you are here?
I'm just going to walk up to the bridge.
Okay. So you walk up to the bridge, and like the guards come out and say, oh, are you planning on crossing the bridge today?
I'm here to meet some of my kin.
Ah, we don't see your type here very often. You are some kind of fey creature, correct?
I am an elf mortal.
Yes, yes, I could tell by the fact that you are not human.
You do realize there are many types of fey creatures.
Yes. And
that's what people say, but they all look the same. Sorry.
Some of them steal children, and others of them are just strange and visit us at times. And sometimes they, and he lists like all of these, like this extremely wide range of things, which are not necessarily untrue about fey creatures, but many of which do not apply to elves whatsoever. And I hear sometimes that they can't pass a trail of rose petals, or else they have to stop and count every one of them. And then sometimes they're you just keep...
Oh, that one is definitely true.
So he goes over this entire list of
I had things. A human child once. God, where did I put it?
How often do those need to eat?
So anyway, I'm here to see some of my kin.
So you're standing there, basically in, you know, fairly visible to anybody that would be observing the bridge. Does what does the rest of the party do as Widow's Cry goes out there?
Well, now we're nearing the woods with the witches, right?
No, you're the other. This is the opposite direction.
Oh, son of a bitch!
We're on the east side of the. What's on the other side of the span?
The Holy Kingdom.
Oh. Isn't that the place where the orcs took over?
No, no, no. That's the Empire proper. The Holy Kingdom is a province that has been given over to the Cult of the New God, where basically the pontiff and all of the upper echelons of the faith live.
Yeah, basically, I'm not touching the other side of the bridge. I will burst into flames there because there will be enough holy water and gasoline to catch me on fire. I'm sure that it's made of napalm.
Don't worry. That should not be a problem.
So if you guys...
King's interested in crossing, but won't. We're just kind of standing there on our mounts, I guess.
All right. So as you guys are standing there for a while, Widow's Cry kind of moves away from the party, goes up to the things and talks to the guards. You see these storm clouds kind of gather, and the storm blows up really, really fast. And the wind starts blowing, and you feel like, you know, little dots of rain start hitting you. And the sky gets really, really dark for a moment. And then there is a flash of lightning. For a moment, Widow's Cry, you and the guards especially are blinded. And then standing next to you is another elf, but this one does not quite look like Widow's Cry. This one appears more like... it's a more human-looking elf. They have the fine features. They're tall and thin, but their hair is like this. Their hair looks almost like storm clouds with lightning darting through it.
I will bow because I'm going to assume he's higher ranking than me. In Elvish, explain that I have come with knowledge of the troll spell. Explain what the witch has told us, and provide him the book. With my notes that I have discovered.
So he looks at you and goes, this could be a great boon. If we could work out the proper things that the Diabolus wants to use this power for, this would be a simple matter of working out how to do this ritual to redirect the power.
Indeed.
If we work out these particulars of this ritual, I trust we could count on you to perform the particulars that need to happen in order to prepare the ritual to redirect this power.
If I can.
It's good to know that we have elves like you in the world. You make the universe a better place just by existing.
He'll bow again.
And of course,
you know, I can't appear in thunderclouds, so.
Well, yeah. More impressive than that, so. But yeah, you know he's... from how he has said this to you, that's like the... Because... You know, elves and upper echelon Bay Court people are very big on proper forms of address. You know, he's not just heaping praise on you. That is essentially the way that he would say that you've done a good job as a servant, and I will tell your master that you have done a good job. But it's in that flowery way that, you know, that Fey Court people like to do.
He will bow and respond appropriately.
And he nods. And then, like, the rest of you, before you have a chance to really do anything else, the winds, like, whip up again, and there's another flash of lightning, and you just see Widow's Cry at the bridge.
I will not die to that book again.
The killer downtime book has been handed off.
You're done. Let's go. We're wasting valuable time.
So now the theory with this is not the way you need to take things, but the elves may contact you to do specific missions to help set up this ritual, and it could be that it saves the world by redirecting this power to the Diabolus. So if you want to do that, that is now an option that is in place in the future.
When Widow's Cry gets back, well, the good news is he was able to confirm that the village on the other side of the map is maybe not as corrupt as we thought. They no longer need to die.
So yes. So, well, shall we? Widow's Cry doesn't seem as intent on making sure that a village is destroyed now. Does this make all of you feel better?
Sort of not.
No.
As the last of the lightning cracks, Fringe will cackle gleefully and whip her dogs and then dash off towards the other direction.
So do you guys follow Widow's Cry as Widow's Cry immediately turns around to the next destination?
You mean Fringe?
Fringe, or Fringe, yeah, sorry. Sorry, I got my crazy fade.
I guess I'll go get back on my horse.
So, just to be clear, the second one, you're going to go visit the Witch's Lodge, correct?
Widow's Cry will stop briefly in one of the towns and buy probably being overpriced, being just off a highway and all, but
I had 5 weeks of rations, so
yeah, got a bunch of rations.
Yeah, I made sure that I had plenty, so I'm more than happy to share.
And the dogs have bugbear traps.
Yeah. But Widow's Peak will buy, I don't know, whatever gold will buy for rations.
Okay. They are happy to get this.
Yeah.
It's not a major city, but there is a small settlement on the side of the bridge because it makes sense for them to be able to reprovision and sell stuff to people coming across from the Holy Kingdom before they head into the city, so...
How much rations does a gold buy me there?
Hundreds of days.
Yeah, I think it's 2 silver. Oh no, is it copper? I was just looking at it.
Yeah, it's real cheap.
Yeah. I would say it's probably slightly inflated because we're used to selling to caravans. So
it's 1 week for a copper.
So I will fill
about half as much as you normally do.
I will fill the wagon with rations and tell them to keep the rest.
All right. They are thrilled with this. Thank you, good elf. And they specifically call you an elf.
Oh, dear. Probably have enough feed for the horses, too.
Oh, yeah.
With that.
You're not going to feed the horses bugbear?
Oh, come on. It's going to be like, by the time we get over there, do you know how much food Vigdis is going to eat?
Come on. That's a good point.
Good thing he's a good tracker because, you know, I'm sure he'll find you guys wherever you're at.
Yes, this is true.
I'm assuming that you left a note in the drop box telling Vigdis the different places you're going to drop off.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, yes, just to make sure, you guys were going to the Witch's Lodge next in the Claims?
Yeah.
Because that's about halfway between here and the Lake of Sighs.
Yes.
Okay.
I've got to open up my map. See.
And I don't like this place.
And these aren't the witches that I'm hunting after. These are
different witches.
But they might still...
These are witches that that we should probably not trust.
But they might have chicken huts. Maybe all witches have chicken huts.
You don't know.
Maybe Abby's hiding her chicken hut. Or maybe she just is a chick hut at this point and it has to grow up.
Oh, yeah, we're heading at least closer in the direction. We got to go west.
Yeah.
Yeah, we need the forest of screams here, guys. All right. Well, let's go do your thing.
So, for your travel. All right. Hey, look at that. Only one good thing happens in the 5 days that you're heading out into the claims. So let's see what one good thing happens in your trip. Positive result. Good thing. Two, that won't happen again because that's silly. All right. So
we still get our boon, right?
Oh, yeah. You still have your boon until the end of the session.
Oh, even better.
Everyone, give me a perception test.
16.
Natural 20, 23.
Hey, that's exactly what I rolled, a natural 20 with a 3.
Wow.
That's a 4. Then.
And I'm having all of you make this test because I figured if Fringe was the only one that saw it, Fringe would be the only one that knows it exists.
Oh, God. Not an unreasonable expectation.
So I'm assuming just about everybody saw it then.
Unless it's a chicken hut, in which case the entire party is turning right now.
Yeah, of course. Everyone would know if it was a chicken hut.
Totally yours. All right. So you see a small chest lodged in the ground. It looks like it was buried and maybe like some storm came through and uncovered like the corner of it. So do you attempt to dig this out?
Widow's Cry will simply pull up next to it and wait because he's pretty sure that Fringe will be on the ground very, very soon.
Yes, Fringe will be on the ground digging it out.
I have dogs to dig it out for me now.
That's true. The dogs dig up the chest. So, the chest is free. It's been buried here in the mud for a while. What do you wish to do with it?
I'll check it for traps.
Okay, give me an intellect test.
Are there traps? ? 21.
You do not notice any traps.
Okay, I will attempt to unlock it with my thieves' tools.
All right.
Unlocking the trash. I got an 8, so that didn't work out well.
Yes, the small chest does not appear to open. Does anyone else wish to attempt to...
The gods have told me that actually that lock is made by the same company, told me through her.
Oh, yeah.
The lock's made by the same company as the door from the other place. Try one of these two keys, and they'll hand over the keys for the door that Vigdis ripped off the wall.
So yeah, now you can make another test with a boon.
19.
All right. So amazingly enough, it actually works. Click. So inside, there was like nice padding inside the thing at one point in time, but it's, you know, the mud is kind of seeped in because it's not waterproof. And dun, dun, 7, so that's table 2, 13. Okay, that's not it. All
right. We found something so awesome, it disappeared.
All right, so what is inside this this chest is a coin.
A?
Yes, a single coin.
Close it, run away.
When you open the box and if you look at the coin and you pick up the coin, the padding that was keeping the coin safe disappears when you set the coin down on top of it. So anything that you set the coin on top of becomes transparent.
Oh. Well, obviously, Fringe will be keeping this.
But the coin isn't invisible, Fringe.
She says yes, and then puts it on top of her head, and we'll get in the chicken coop and lash at her dogs.
Well, what's really disturbing is it makes the surface layer transparent. So when Fringe puts this on her head, her skin disappears, and you see like veins and muscles.
Oh, fantastic!
Hold on. Okay, I do not take insanity.
Hey guys, watch this. Oh man. All right. So we are the after you find that, the rest of the travel is uneventful. You see basically a trail that leads to a homestead. There is a lodge sitting out here in the middle of nowhere. It doesn't look like they've worked their fields in a while, and there are kind of gnarled, twisted, dark trees all around the thing. And this time in spring, they should have leaves on them, but they don't. And how are you going to deal with this? Because Abby, you actually got an invitation.
Yeah, I know. Well, so it's a farmhouse?
Yeah, I mean, it's basically a lodge farmhouse type thing.
Well, and we've rested since, right?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, you've had 5 days, so.
All right, number one, I'm going to cast Magic Acorns. Because I have no trust for these people.
When Abby casts that spell, Widow's Cry will go ahead and attune the bow.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's a very good idea. I have no trust, none whatsoever.
Do I see any chicken huts or signs of chicken huts?
No, but you're not sure if the lodge could stand up.
Oh. Okay. In that case, Fringe will approach the lodge and like walk around it and look for any signs that it could stand up.
Okay. So you two are out there casting spells. Fringe darts off next to the house.
I'll hide and stuff in the shadows.
Oh yeah, I figured. And, so what is Kane doing as this is going on?
He's pretty much lost kind of on what's happening. Did she even tell us why we're here yet?
Yes, these people could have been causing some of the chaos that could be fueling the reason for the need for the troll spell.
But did you explain that you were invited here?
Yeah, I would have to explain that they understand that I'm a practitioner of the old faith, and they seem to think that I would be a good fit for these people, and I don't think that I really am, so I don't really have a whole lot of trust for them. However, if they can prove that they're not harmful, which, given their distrust for Mother Bastion, I didn't trust her either, given that she tried to kill us, I can't say they're wholly wrong there, but at the same time, I also can't say that they're wholly right if they're trying to cause chaos in the city.
So they're not a good fit for you. So are they too big or too small?
Have you ever tried to wear a corset that's too small? I know you're an elf and all.
I was going to say, Widow's Cry may have, but...
Probably.
It's not pleasant, is it?
So the three of you that are staying back and preparing for this, give me a perception test, as you are always down the road.
13, 10 plus 3.
20. Okay.
Dun, dun, dun. And I'm not counted in this group because I'm walking around the house.
Right. We will deal with you separately. And basically your areas for this, you have the abandoned crops, and you have the road where you guys are at, and then you have up next to the house.
I mean, we should definitely try to talk before we try to kill everybody. But
what?
Anybody that makes a successful perception test, you notice there are two guards on the front porch.
I don't know. I just heard the fight music and got the flyby of the terrain, so...
Thanks.
So, since Fringe is scouting ahead, when you get close to one of the trees, Fringe, give me a will test.
With one bane.
Can I use my trickery to cancel out the bane?
What exactly does trickery say that would cause it to cancel it out?
It's a challenge roll.
Okay. That's fine.
Okay. It's one of my uses of trickery this round. All right, so will, I got plus two, will. Oh, no, that's seven. That's a fail. All
right, so you look up at the tree, and you hear this weird noise, and suddenly... And if anybody's looking at this from a distance, you don't see this. You just see these kind of black, gnarled trees that don't have a lot of leaves to them. But as Fringe turns around, you actually see bodies hanging from all of the branches as if they have been hanged and have been partially rotted. And the bodies look like you and all of your companions.
Okay.
So you will take a point of insanity for that.
Oh,
and
no.
You are also now frightened.
Oh, see, that bothered me. I'll be frightened.
Now, make another will challenge.
15.
Okay. So, basically, the second will challenge was to make sure that when you became frightened, you didn't, like, yelp out and make a noise that the guards would have heard.
So
you held your tongue... But you just saw, like, you and everyone else you're traveling with being hung from a tree.
All right, well, I mean, whatever.
Fringe. Like, you know what you're talking about, right? Whatever.
So, yeah, but unfortunately, the downside here is, Fringe, your frightened condition lasts for one round plus one round for each of your...
Points in sanity?
Yeah.
Okay, so for the next, like, minute...
Yeah.
Oh, and I cannot take a fast turn. All right.
So basically, you're like envisioning all of these different ways that these corpses could have gotten up there, and it's like playing on your mind constantly.
I don't think that would give Fringe the frightened condition.
I'm trying to figure out. Wait a minute. Fringe is hanging up there too, isn't she?
Yeah. Maybe you aren't who you think you are.
Is it me or the witch?
That's always... Well, yeah, it's the witch, but, you know.
Okay, so I'm not even up there.
Yeah.
Whatever.
Well, I picture, like, Fringe, in her particular state of mind, your frightened condition is just... You're even more distracted than normal.
Yeah, I don't know if frightened is the right word.
May not be the right word, but it is the technical rules.
Right, it's the affliction. It's just... It just doesn't apply.
Yeah, but well, yeah. You are frightened as a condition because you're obsessing over what you just saw.
Yeah.
Okay, so the rest of you, you see the two guards at the front of the house. You haven't really seen Fringe. She just kind of took off. So what are you guys planning on doing?
Oh. This is all madness, isn't it?
Oh, not at all.
It is all madness. I'm just wondering where the giant rabbit hole is at this point.
Well, you're the one that was invited. You should probably lead the way.
Yeah. So, adjust my hat, and...
Yeah, because you have a hat, because that's a thing.
Yeah, come stock.
So you come walking up to the guards, they see your hat, they look at the people accompanying you, and they go, should we have been expecting you?
Yes, you should.
What is the name that I should give the sisters?
Abigail Tuller.
All right, we will go speak to the sisters immediately. And one of the guards, they open the door. One of the guards stands like halfway in and halfway out. The other one walks in. They're saying some things. And then three very attractive women walk out. All of them you notice they have the tips of their fingers and their lips are all stained blue.
You should get your circulation checked.
Yes.
And the lead of the three of them walks up to you and goes, "Welcome. We have heard so much about you. We are glad that you decided to take us up on your invitation. I am Kalenda, this is Rose, and this is Natalia. Who might these people be?"
"They are my companions."
"Ah. So you are saying that you already have your own cadre of minions. That is wonderful. That's a good start." So,
yeah, Kane's German take a breath is perfect.
Now we come inside and we will talk about making sure that they are properly initiated and what you will need to do in order to join us. And we'll have a pleasant time of it. We were just about to serve dinner.
We will discuss your order a little bit more before I decide whether I determine to join the order or not, but sure.
So they bring all of you in and he nods, and there's some servants that go and bring in it's a really nice spread of food for all of you guys. "Please eat, enjoy yourselves. It's amazing that you are working with an elf. That is a good sign. It shows that you can bridge the gap among many different cultures. That's something we're definitely looking for."
And why?
"Well," she goes, these are properly your minions, correct?"
I prefer the term friends, but or at least companions. And or at least people who tolerate me," looking over at Kane.
So make an intellect challenge to see if they are willing to accept these as people that are completely in your confidence.
That would be a 14 plus 3.
So 17. She looks and she goes, "Well, if they are your friends," you get the feeling she can't say the word friends without doing the
air quotes.
"If they are your friends, then obviously they are going to undergo the test to make sure that they are properly acquainted with our ways later. So we will deal with that then, but we will go ahead and explain this now. As the Sisters of the Blue Hand, we understand that there is a horrible wrong that has happened, and that is the true Goddess of the Moon has been locked away from the world. The other gods are jealous of her and have trapped her in an alternate world where she cannot fully influence effects in this world. And we are seeking to free her. The normal confines of society have all been set up by the gods that are oppressing her, and therefore we are doing what we can to undermine current authority until we can gather enough power to break her free from her prison and return the true Goddess of the Moon back to her place. This troll spell that you have encountered could provide enough power to punch a hole in her prison if you redirect it towards her. And then the Goddess of the Moon will show up and our sisterhood will be fully ascendant."
"Does Widow's Cry know anything about a moon goddess who's been locked away?"
"You can make an intellect test."
"No, he does not."
You know, I mean, it's part of the old faith that there is a moon goddess. That, you know, watches over magic and things happening at night and things like that. It's not really the primary goddess that most witches follow, but it's not entirely unheard of either. But this particular thing about her being trapped in another world is not something that is commonly said among people of the old faith. It's not a thing that most people in the old faith believe.
Yeah, this sounds like heresy. Heresy everywhere. Burn the heretics. Wait, no. Wrong game.
So, are you ready to join us now? We can get out the nectar and then you can become one with us, and then we will put your minions through their trials to make sure that they're worthy, and then we'll be all set.
Okay, number one. Minions. What why do you have to have minions?
Minions, a word. It's people that are beholden to you because you are very important to the right functioning of the world.
The elf will grab a banana off the tray. Banana.
In what world?
In the world to come when the rightful goddess shows up. And we're going to cut away for a moment. Fringe, give me a perception test.
Perceiving. Fringe is perceiving. And is this after their conversation?
It's while it's going on.
Right. So I'm probably still frightened then.
Yeah.
12.
So. All right. So with your 12, you notice that there is, it almost looks like a storm cellar. And it's got a huge chain and a padlock on it behind the back of the house.
Oh, well, that's not good. Because if it has a basement, it probably doesn't stand up. Fringe is disappointed by that. But
unless it's chained to the ground so it can't stand up.
Yeah, she was gonna say she will take the time to undo the chain just in case. So I guess I'll roll for that. Let's see. Unlocking stuff. Roll. Unlocking chain. Just barely with an 11.
All right. So you unlock the chain or the padlock on the chain. Take the chain away. Do you open the doors or are you staying where you're at?
Oh no, I'm not gonna open the door.
Okay. So. That's what Fringe is doing. When we cut back to Fringe, your frightened condition will be gone, but because it'll be, you know, you've spent enough time unlocking chains and scouting the outside of the house, cutting back to the dinner conversation. So the three witches inside there are looking at the rest of you going, I am sorry, we don't mean to imply anything by saying that you are minions. It's just, in our sisterhood, we see the sisterhood first and everyone else second. And I apologize if that is offensive in any way to you. We greatly value the service of anyone bound to our witches.
Yeah, that implies a lesser people. I'm sorry, but I've been watching for Kane's reaction here. I've been a whore most of my life, and unfortunately, I've been arrested, kicked, beaten, slapped around by mostly unpleasant men, and you're turning around and telling me I'm now all of a sudden important.
You are, because what you don't realize is you have managed to survive all of that, and you've gotten stronger, and you've made connections through your appearance, through your ability to communicate with others, and most importantly, through your magic. And because you have survived, you have proven that you should be on the top of any social chain that emerges after the goddess returns.
Whatever you say, mortal. Whatever you say.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
I was just curious, is this like similar to what we were thinking about doing by giving it to Diabolus instead, or?
It sounds similar. You would be redirecting instead of the troll spell, just, you know, eroding everything so that the void takes reality so that the trolls can say they won over the elves. This would basically be redirecting the energy to whoever this moon goddess is to free her from her prison, for however wise you think that might be.
For reference, the elf is fairly sure that they are misguided and tricked by someone, and they're just going to be releasing the demon lord anyway. That's his entire take on this.
So,
I'm with the elf.
Abigail and Cain, you've had some interactions with religion. You can both make an intellect test. You know what the standard religion says, but you don't know whether you have heard of this particular branch of.
And do we get to use our lovely little boon?
Well, yeah, of course, because you read the signs and the birds told you what the gods wanted you to know.
Okay, 14 plus 3 is 17 plus 5 is 22.
Okay. And what did Cain get?
13.
Okay. So both of you, you don't know specifics of this, but Cain, what you can recall now, the more you hear about them, you're pretty sure that they are listed as an official cult among the Inquisition. So you don't know specifics about what, you know, their heresy is supposed to be, but you do know that beyond normal followers of the old faith, these guys are branded as heretics that should be burned and destroyed by the Inquisition.
Oh, these are bad guys.
Yeah, at least according to the Inquisition, this is not just normal old faith practitioners. This is a cult that needs to be weeded out and set on fire.
And
Abby, but I don't know why.
You're not sure why, but you do know that much.
Abby is getting less and less comfortable. What would Abby's teachings?
So basically, everything that you have learned from all of the other witches is none of the gods of the old faith have exiled any of the other gods. They all work. I mean, they might have their rivalries, they might have little issues, but none of them have said, you are too powerful, we will lock you away. That's just not a thing that makes any sense in your view of this religion. In fact, you're not even sure it would be possible, really, for them to do something like that, because they are kind of all intrinsically bound as part of nature. Like, you can't shut part of nature away from the rest of nature and still have reality function the way it's supposed to.
Yeah.
So you're pretty sure, at least according to your religious beliefs, this doesn't jive with everything that you've learned.
So, now I have to figure out how to get us away from this table.
I'm not too worried about that.
How long has it been since we came into the building?
It has been over 10 minutes.
And how many minions have we seen?
You saw the two guards, and then you saw some servants, but they don't look particularly combat ready. So you've seen about maybe 5 other people. So, shall we get the Night Maiden's Nectar so that you can take it and see the true glory of the Night Maiden now?
I don't know. Are there any braziers involved?
No. All you do is you take the Nectar of the Night Maiden and you place it on your tongue, and then it shows you an alternate reality where you understand everything that the Night Maiden wants you to know about reality.
And how big is her grin, and how scary is her grin?
Oh, she looks fucking crazy at this point.
And good. That's mother. Okay, I'm going to put this on a scale in Abby's mind. Like fucking crazy, like fringe off her rocker, like dangerous off her rocker fringe. Or Mother Bastion, crazy off her rocker, doesn't realize it off her rocker.
Looks like Mother Bastion talking about fashion sense in the middle of a slaughtered village type of...
Okay, well, this is danger.
So, are you ready to take the nectar?
Unfortunately, while I greatly appreciate the offer for joining your particular brand of faith, I and my companions will have to respectfully decline. We did want to make sure that we declined your offer in person, because it would be disrespectful of anyone to not do so in person.
Oh, I see. Well then, I guess there's nothing more to be said here. There will be absolutely no repercussions. Please leave in peace as not a member of our sisterhood.
Yeah, and at this point,
Widow's cry, standing up and head towards the door.
Yep. Run like hell.
So you guys all leave the place? Kane, are you leaving with them?
Oh, I'm fine with leaving with them, yeah.
Okay, so Fringe, give me it's been a while, so, and these are new people, so give me another stealth test.
Stealthy fridge stealthy being stealth to stealth stealthing 21.
All right, so in the distance you see your companions walking out, and you see the two guards from the front walk around to the back, and they look at the storm cellar doors and they go, "Really? Did you forget to lock up again afterwards?" And he goes, "No, I could have sworn I locked up." He's like, "Well, it's unlocked now. Like, it doesn't matter. We were going to have to unlock it anyway." "Yep. It's really, really a shame we're going to have to do this." And they open up the storm cellar doors, and one of them reaches a hand inside the door and pulls a lever. And you hear this clanging, this loud noise, like a big metal thing opening.
Robot chicken. And,
you see one of them holding out a thing to the thing that's coming up the stairs, and it almost looks like maybe like a napkin that somebody might have touched. And emerging from underneath this thing is this huge, even bigger than the bugbear, this hulking humanoid creature with a bull's head. And the two of them go, "Well, you're going to have to murder someone again." And you get this horrible grin across the bull's face, and it sniffs the cloth and starts looking in the direction of, you know, where the you guys were, where the rest of your party was coming from. So you're behind this thing, and it's looking towards your companions at this point.
Oh man, I have a really good idea, but I don't want to give up the witch guys. So I'm not gonna do the idea, but I want you to know that I had the thought and it almost happened.
Okay, I'm very proud of the thought that you didn't actually.
Yeah, awesome. Yeah. So I was gonna duck around the building, and as I go around the corner, steal the guys of one of the guards, and then get in the way of the thing and be like, "Oh no, I'm sorry, I misthought. They wanted you to destroy the house."
Yeah.
And come back to the party, but I can't give up the witch guys. So instead, I will just run back to my dog sled and tell you guys some bull monster is coming. It's trying to kill you. I point to Widow's, not peak, Widow's cry. And then I'll yell, "Yeah!" And then off with the dogs.
So Fringe mentions some bullheaded monster and takes off on the dog sled. And about the time that the dog sled takes off, you hear this horrendous like snorting noise. And you look down the road. You guys are still in that band. You're not right next to the house, but you're on the road next to the house. You're not quite in the abandoned fields yet. And the Minotaur is up next to the house. So you're one area away, but this thing snorts loudly and looks at all of you. And Fringe is out in the free field, so she is two areas away from the Minotaur. So, we are going to start on a fast turn. What would you guys like to do as you see this Minotaur out there?
So this is what they meant by no repercussions.
Yeah.
They're not doing anything. They just happened to stick a Minotaur on you.
Yeah.
Also, in this particular world, and since you're from this province, you will know that just like bugbears, Minotaurs are like the apex predators of all of the beast men.
Yes, because nothing says predator like a bull.
Well, nothing says predator like things that are merged with humans that aren't natural. So,
well, bulls aren't predators, but they're apex. Right?
Good news. Anybody with ranged weapons? Oh no, you should have done it that way. Aim there.
Yeah.
Get your boons.
The birds told me that if we ever fire weapons, we should do it this way.
Well, tactically speaking, we all have horses, and I mean, I'm sure the Minotaur is not terribly slow, but
we probably kite depending it. On how fast the horses are versus the Minotaur, we may be able to just outpace them.
Yeah, exactly.
Using the cart as just kind of like, "All right, you want to run to us? We'll just we'll just throw shit at you.
All right. So what would you like to do?
I'll take a slow turn.
Okay.
Low turn.
I'm not happy with these things having the ability of having one of these things. And again,
the fact that they have a beast man that they're using does not speak well for. So Fringe and Widow's Cry are doing slow turns. What's doing?
I need to get within. How he's within medium range right now.
It's one area away. So.
So yeah. Medium. So,
yes. Yes.
Well. Hope. I need to be closer than that.
Oh, it'll change soon enough.
It will. I will go slow turn then.
Okay. And Kane?
I guess I'll shoot an arrow at it, I guess. We're not trying to flee, in other words, right?
Not at this point.
All right.
Speak for yourselves. We done all your shit. It's my turn now. We're going to the screaming forest. We're getting my hut.
All right, so Kane, right. Loose your arrow.
All right, so I get two boons, apparently.
Yes, because Abigail told you exactly how you should shoot it. And the birds will fly.
All right, that's an 18.
All right, an 18 does hit its defense.
All right, so one, two... Three die six. One, two.
Good grief.
No, it's only two die six. I think I messed up here. Boom. Combat prowess. Is it five?
What's that?
Oh, I have combat expertise now. Yeah, so I do 3d6. Okay. Yep. So that would be 15.
All right. So you hit it. I mean, it's a solid blow.
Wasn't five more than his. Sorry, that wasn't five more than what I needed to hit him, was it?
No. Okay. It's a solid hit, but yeah, you notice while it doesn't shrug it off, it definitely looks like it can take a lot more punishment than that.
Yeah.
So, is anyone else taking a fast turn?
Nope.
Okay. So, Well, that is its special attack. Okay. So, as its special attack, it is going to use Bull Rush.
Yay.
On a fast turn, it can move twice its normal movement speed and make an attack. So it's basically just like it lowers its horns, and I just got the brief image of Tim Curry in the darkness get up, lowering his horns and running and seeing the horns bob. But basically the Minotaur just like kind of hunkers down its shoulders and takes off with horrendous speed straight towards Kane, and, like whams straight into him with the horns. And now he is... at the same range as everybody except Fringe. So, Bull Rush, Horns Attack. Ooh, okay. So that's two boons. So, that is a... There's an 18 hit Kane.
16.
So,
did you ask what my defense was?
Yeah. So he hits you by two. And its horn attack then does 7 points of damage. But you did fall prone.
And fall prone?
Yes.
Okay.
So that was the Minotaur's fast turn. Everyone's slow turn.
So I'm like off my horse or something.
Yeah, I would say he probably just knocked you off your horse. I won't make you take any extra damage, though, because he already horned you.
I am feeling horny.
And Abby's going, speaking of that.
Oh, God.
Guess what spell Abby just cast?
I know what spell is coming now.
Yeah, everybody knows what spell Abby's going to cast.
You can't cut through a Minotaur's horn. It's indestructible. What would you take as a trophy?
By the way, with the boon,
I thought of too.
With the boon, I exceed a 20.
Yeah, okay. All right.
It was a 19. It was a 16 plus 3 mm-hmm. plus the 5 for the boon. So I would not have exceeded 20 without that boon, Jared.
And that's against its will, correct?
Against its will. So okay. It's a 24.
All right. So, how many it's
All right. So, ecstasy, it is dazed and now prone for one round. it's feeling intense pleasure. So, yes, yeah. It just charged him.
Yeah. So, it can't use actions for how many?
All right. So, hold on. Scrolling to the spell description. Dazed for one round, slowed for one round after, and he's now prone.
Okay. So it can't take any actions next turn.
Right.
So basically, here's the image. The Minotaur charges with horrendous speed and hits Kane and knocks him off the horse with his horns. Then Abby casts the spell, and the Minotaur right next to Kane is like dry humping the ground.
He got a whiff of the horse.
So, Kane, you're uncomfortably close to a Minotaur that is doing unspeakable things to the ground right now.
I already felt uncomfortable.
All right, so that was Abby's turn. Who else would like to take a slow turn?
What is Cry is going to move another movement back,
okay,
and then also cast Battle Prowess.
Okay, so you're out by the road, so you're an area away from it. All right, and then you cast your spell, so you will be better able to attack things later.
Yep.
Okay, and Fringe, are you just going to run, you know, straight out?
I'm tempted, but they don't have Vigdis and probably wouldn't be able to track me. Although, I mean, I guess I do leave trails of fat everywhere I go.
Yeah, I think hearing the dogs barking and seeing like the runners from the sleigh that shouldn't work in the ground. Well,
I've got the glass cage, so it's always an eerie silence whenever it runs.
Yeah, that's true. But yeah, I'm gonna. I mean, plus you might circle around to see where they're at just to make sure, you know. More to see that the thing didn't kill all of them and is going to track you down.
Yeah, that's kind of what I'm thinking. I'll slow down and stop and apply poison to 3 crossbow bolts.
Okay, so you're going to stop at 2 area or 1 area away now from it. Okay. And
then short range.
Gotcha. Okay, so Fringe and Widow's Cry are 1 area away out in the fields. Okay, so that is round 1. So this next round, the Minotaur is dazed. And it's also prone, so anyone attacking the Minotaur gets a boon. So who would like to take a fast turn?
I'll take a fast turn.
Okay.
I'll shoot one of my hand crossbow poison bolts at the Minotaur there. And I get two boons because of what's his face? Widow's Cry yelling at us?
The ground's the only thing getting a boon right now.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. You get one from Abby.
21?
Yes, you get one.
That definitely hits its defense.
Does it hit over 5?
21. Yes.
Okay, then I will shoot another crossbow bolt at this motherfucker.
All right.
14 probably misses.
A 14 does not hit it.
Okay, so I'm down to 8 bolts. 7 bolts, and only one of which is poisoned, but he has to make a strength challenge roll. I got all the rules here.
All right.
Yeah. Make a strength challenge. No banes or boons.
All right, so that's a 25 on the strength challenge roll.
All right, well, it'll resist this poison then.
Turns out minotaurs are good at that.
And, yeah, some damage. Just 3d6. 13.
All right. So, you strike it again. It's a solid hit. It appears to be injured by it, but this huge mass of muscle and horns, it seems like it can still take quite a bit more punishment than that.
Tis but a scratch.
Exactly. So anyone else want to take fast turns?
Sure. So I get 3 boons, 1 for Abby, 1 for Prone, 1 for the attuned bow. So the first one, high roll, would be a plus 20.
That will definitely hit its defense.
I'm not going to bother roll the second one, or the second set, because I don't have anything that does anything special above certain levels. So as long as it hits, we'll just call it good. And it takes 7 points of arrow damage.
All right. So the arrow, another arrow thunks into another mass of muscles on it, and it makes noises like it got hit by an arrow, and then it makes other noises, and, you know, the foreground. Okay, so who else would like to take a fast turn?
And that's it.
So, yeah, the Minotaur is not taking any turns at all, so slow turns.
Here, I'll chop at it with my. I'm going to stand and then chop at it. That's what I was waiting for. Ooh, okay. So that would be a 23.
That definitely hits him.
All right. So I do a D6 combat expertise, forceful strike. Now, is this demon, devil, fairy, spirit, or undead?
Unfortunately, no. It is a beast man.
Okay, so it's still 5d6, so I'm going to use a Divine Smite on it.
Despite being unnatural, it does not trigger any paladin special abilities.
Ooh, 18, 20, 25, 27 points.
All right. Well, after hitting it that hard, you definitely see it, unlike some of these other hits where it was like, oh, that was a little bit painful, that one, it like took notice for a second, and it stops grunting one way and grunts another way for a minute, and kind of shakes its head because it noticed that. That was a serious hit. And it's looking very bad now, because now you've actually opened it up to where it's seeping a lot more blood than it was just from the little arrow hits. It would be Abigail's turn, but Abigail fell into an alternate dimension for a moment. Okay, so we will get back to Abby later. The Minotaur can't take a turn, so we will go into round 3. It is still slowed and prone, but it is no longer... Hey, Steve's back. Yep. Hello? Hello, Steve? Okay, so on round 3, Steve will join us momentarily. On round 3, everybody's things clear off. The Minotaur can take actions now, but he's still prone and slowed. So, can only take a slow turn, its speed is halved, and it cannot benefit from increases to speed. Okay, so who would like to take a fast turn this time?
Me.
Okay.
Kane would like to try and get another good chop on this thing. Ooh, that's pretty good. Another 23.
That hits.
So that'd be 5d6 again, plus 2.
Nice.
So 10, 21, 23 points.
All right. So Kane, you, the thing starts to, you know, it stops, you know, mutilating the ground with its appendages. And it kind of gets up on its hands and knees, and you, like, spin around and do this, like, you know, momentous chop, and you just dig deep into its throat, cut it open, blood sprays everywhere, and it falls over dead.
Are guards visible from the house?
You don't see them at the moment. What would you guys like to do? You are no longer in combat because, you know, nobody's immediately here to threaten you.
Oh, what is Cry's going back to the house?
Oh, yes. We're killing everybody in the house now. We're burning the house to the ground.
Yeah, he's just burning the house down.
Yes.
Okay. So, you don't see the guards at the front door yet, so you can get up to the front of the house. What would you like to do?
Widow's Cry is staying slightly behind everybody else because he has a bow.
I'll leave the dogs back with Widow's Cry.
Okay, so basically, yeah, you guys are back on the road, one area back from the house.
And then I will stealth up to the house and light it on fire.
Okay.
After chaining up that back door.
It's like you guys are playing Call of Cthulhu or something.
Actually, why don't you chain the front door?
Okay, I'll do that. I'll bar the back door and I'll chain the front door.
Okay.
I like the way you're thinking, Fringe.
Give me your stealth test.
All right. Do you want to give me some advice on how to stealth?
Yes, I would.
Oh, great. Thanks.
And as a matter of fact, I'm going to add to that, and I'm going to do, I'm going to add to that my guidance check, which is separate from prayer.
Hold on. I bought a thing perfect for this. I'll just drink my potion of invisibility.
Okay.
And then I'll
wear the birdcage, yeah.
Okay, yeah. So yeah, nobody can hear you run around the side, grab the chains and the lock, run back to the front, and...
Can I see, like, the pot they had inside from the window? Or from where I'm standing?
No, the... All of the windows have, like, shades over them, so it's hard to see in the house.
And, what does it mean to attack as if blinded?
Three banes.
Okay.
Guidance. I'll knock two of those away.
While Widow's Cry is while he's doing that, Widow's Cry is going to distract the people in the house. He's going to shoot at where he remembers the kettle being, so there's a loud clanging noise away from the door.
Okay. That is
So
I don't make any noise. I have a birdcage that makes me completely silent.
Yeah, but, you know.
There's chains. When he's chained the front door.
So
Yeah. I get silence within a whole yard.
Before you guys go, though, Fringe doesn't need to do this, but you guys see the trees. So I need everyone to give me a will test with one bane when they see the trees. Because you also see...
The gods told us about the trees.
That's true. That is true. So just a will test.
Net 11.
Nice.
Net of 12.
And what did Kane get?
14.
Okay.
14.
So I don't know whether it makes Abby feel better or not to know she's not fazed by seeing her and her friends hanging from trees.
Oh no, it makes her feel worse. Without that boon, she was a babbling heap.
You are all unaffected by the hangman trees, and so Fringe, basically, or not Fringe, Widow's Cry, if you do this, go ahead and make your attack roll.
So it'd be down to, you said you knocked two banes off that?
And then the normal one with the boons for the session.
The god said okay. If you ever needed to fire into a house blindly.
So then I get a boon from my bow. I get another boon for the phasing missile spell. Right. So that's two boons.
Net.
Well, and it gets better because does a 19 hit the pot?
Yes. So basically the reason this would still have value whether or not they can hear Fringe, because...
Yes, definitely the 19.
There's no chance, because there's this big clangor inside the house, and they're all worried about something being in the house, there's no chance that anyone is going to wander out of the house and meet you guys, stealth or not. So this was actually definitely beneficial. So they all go running into the kitchen to figure out what's going on, because they're assuming that you guys like broke in a window to try and sneak up on them and kill them from that direction. And while that's going on, you guys are chaining the front door.
The phase missile does 5 points of damage to the pot.
The pot is not destroyed.
But there's an arrow now sticking in the pot.
Exactly.
And to bar the back, I'll have chained my manacles like around the handles as the chains were.
Yeah. Okay. So, what are you using to start the house on fire?
My tinderbox.
Okay. So, give me a test. Is there any skill that you have that would help you start a fire?
I was a spy, and I was a tracker.
Both of those are valid.
Well, yeah, I was gonna say if the tracker is like a wilderness profession, then yeah, I would give you a boon for that.
That is my wilderness profession, yeah.
And Abby would have said, hey, if you ever need to start a house on fire.
The gods said, if you ever needed to start a house on fire.
Oh, dear Lord.
24.
Yeah, you successfully start the house on fire.
At several points.
Yeah.
Abby, you have weird gods.
Yes, I do.
So, is there anything else? I mean, how is Kane reacting to this entire chain of events here?
I'm not sure. You know, he doesn't intend on ever becoming an Inquisitor, and this seems very inquisitorial. But I mean, he's not going to let anyone get killed by it. But if that's what they want to do, then he's not. He pretty much just lets them do what they do. So,
okay.
These people tried to kill us. We killed them right back.
Yeah, I understand.
All right.
We carried their Minotaur and reposted with a house fire.
Yeah, yeah. So you start the house in several places. They're still running around the house making sure that no one's here, including the pen underneath the place where the Minotaur is at, because clearly somebody must be hiding there if they don't see anyone else. And by the time they've checked all of those places and they go in force so that nobody can ambush them, the house is pretty much on fire enough that it's going to be very difficult for them to escape without being caught up in the flames. You all hear terrible, terrible screams as the place burns to the ground. And everyone that participated in the plan will get one corruption, because the guards might have been in on this, but you're not really sure the serving staff was completely 100% in on this whole cult thing.
No. They made it very clear that only minions are allowed around the place. We were an exception. Therefore, the servants are minions. They are complicit.
I understand the logic, but there's still a point of corruption from that.
I will take the point of corruption. No.
So yeah, the farmhouse burns to the ground. People screaming in agony. Nobody escapes.
I did not get a mark of darkness.
Nice. Oh,
do you have to roll a little something when we get a corruption?
D20. Roll, if you roll, is it a 20? I'm pretty sure it's 20. Roll under your.
It's once you get a certain. What is it, 5?
Well, no, whenever you gain corruption, you roll, I think it's a d20. If it's under the amount that you have, then you gain a mark.
Yeah.
If it's not under the amount that you have, you don't gain a mark.
Yes.
Corruption.
Yeah, everybody that got corruption, then I guess we'll have to make that check. For some reason, I was thinking there was a threshold that you didn't have to make it up to.
Whenever you gain corruption, roll a d20.
Okay, so I rolled 11. I'm totally fine. Okay.
Page 36.
Gotcha. Sorry.
However, while I'm still invisible, I will be using my pickpocket rogue trick on the entire party while you watch the flames go down. So everyone, I assume everyone has a gold at least? Or had a gold at least?
So.
I only take one gold. I'm not going to be a total dick. Just so you know, like, take a gold out of your thing. It's not bridges.
Okay. So, did anyone fail their corruption check?
No, I'm good.
By rolling under their corruption.
That's my first point of corruption, I'll point out.
Yes.
I know, right? I'm playing straight crazy.
Yeah,
good time.
My first point of corruption as well.
So no one gets any marks of darkness. The house burns down. What would you guys like to do now that you've burned the house to the ground?
Widow's Cry may need some of that Abbey reduction of corruption soon.
Well, I'll collect the chains and the manacles.
Unfortunately, she can't really reduce corruption. She can reduce...
I thought she had to reduce
insanity.
Oh, that does me no good.
Insanity. No, I get to do... I'm looking at atonement for corruption.
So. Widow's Cry is going to spend a long time trying to figure out why he cares about dead humans. Because
I know you may not care, but it's the fact that the entire world is going to hell and it's really easy to contribute to it.
By killing people trying to make it go to hell?
Yeah. I know, but corruption doesn't care. It just likes the world being more corrupt. Anyway, so the travel to the lake, is that what you're going to do next?
Yep.
All right. So, we probably will not do the full thing at the lake, but we will at least get you guys to the lake. So, this is another 5 days here.
Wait. Okay, fine.
So, wow. Two bad things happen on the way to the lake. So, first, if you guys can mark off 5 more days of provisions.
Man, it's absorbed by the wagon O-meat.
Yeah, that probably, yeah.
We've got a meat wagon.
Yes, you do.
Well, there's other stuff than just meat, but yes.
All right.
A whole wagon full of food. We are not going hungry.
Well, it's either a meat wagon or a corpse cart. And, well, at this point, it might be a corpse cart. By the way, before we do leave, while it may not be... while it may not be appropriate otherwise, Abby will bury the dead.
Yeah, I'll help drag out the bodies / check for any gold or other valuables that might have survived the fire.
All right, so you pull out what remains of Uncle Owen and Aunt Beru, and...
yeah, it happens.
Got a 24 on my intellect check to search the place for valuables that survived the fire.
Unfortunately, not much survived the fire. I will say 4 silver pieces worth of valuables survived the fire.
Well, that's more silver pieces worth of valuables than I had before. So take it.
All right. So, dun, dun, dun. The first bad thing that happened on your way there. You have the party comes across a small farmstead or camp. Everyone in this farmstead have been murdered, and they have been specifically arranged so that the bodies and the body parts form basically anyone that knows anything about magic. It is very clear that these things have been arranged in like a symbolic fashion. So there's like a there's corpses in various geometric patterns. So on top of it being horrific, it's actually sort of channeling part of the void in the way that the bodies have been arranged. So everyone that happens upon this camp, give me a will test with 1 bane.
Which is removed because the gods told us if we ever see bodies displayed as magical runes, we should do this other thing.
Exactly.
I got 10. I got a 12.
Mm. All right. Oh, goody. With my -1 will, I am at a 9.
So the nice thing about this is, as far as I know, you still have room to spare here, so you take a point of insanity.
Oh, man, I missed out on insanity game.
I will happily donate it to the Fringe.
I will cure you of your insanity there.
All right.
Does that just reduce a point?
It does reduce a point of insanity.
Okay.
So
And Widow's Cry will kick a few body parts around in order to make it still artistic, but not magically channeling the void.
Yeah, it's aesthetically pleasing, but it's no longer part of a horrible spell that brings the void closer.
Right.
This was probably done by our friends down at the house, so Abby is going to be very pro burying the damn bodies.
But it's, I mean, how long have the bodies been out?
They're rotted away quite effectively, so it's okay. Probably been at least a couple weeks.
I was going to let the dogs at them, but if they're rotting, then...
It's art.
Yeah, you don't want to feed dogs bad peasant.
Yeah.
That's not good. So, the second, as you get to the Lake of Sighs, the second effect...
If Abby insists on burying them, Widow's Cry will inform her she clearly does not care about beautiful things.
The extra day does not trigger anything good or bad that happens that you take to bury the bodies. And when you come up within sight of the Lake of Sighs, you realize that you're not sure how this happened. It shouldn't have happened. But all of your provisions appear to be rotting and inedible.
Oh, wonderful.
I just spent a gold on those provisions.
So you will have to forage on your way back or find some other provisions, unfortunately.
Does that include my 4 remaining small cakes that provide one day's nourishment?
You know what? Those are elf food. I think we're going to give an allowance for elf food not being being bad yet.
So he'll drop his 2 bottles of now rancid wine, apparently. And start making plans to go get a refund from the village.
Well, I was going to say, it seemed like a really bad sign for all of this stuff, because a lot of this is like heavily, you know, packed or cured. And it just, like, all of a sudden overnight, it looks terrible and has, you know, some of it has maggots in it. It doesn't seem right. This seems like if somebody left the stuff out in the rain for a couple of days, it might have happened, but you're not sure how this happened.
No, it doesn't look right. Does it smell right?
No, it doesn't smell right either. If someone wants to volunteer to eat it, I'll let you test it that way.
Vigdis can try it when he gets back.
You know what? I've got a spell for that. I can take one for the team.
Well, I'm immune to disease, but not poison. So
I can get rid of the sickened. Let's see here. I believe I can. No, because it doesn't take away sickened.
Well, it's diseased, but yeah.
Yeah.
I can do disease.
Oh, I'm immune to disease. If it's just diseased food, I don't care.
Yeah, I was going to say.
If it did a penalty to your health, then it would be something. But if it's actually making you sick, then...
No, I'm immune to damage from disease and from the diseased effect.
This is great. So, like, no one else can eat it, but Widow's Cry can just eat this, like, maggoty, molded up stuff here. Yeah. Awesome.
Oh, man.
I paid for it. I'm going to eat it.
Yeah, I can understand that. I've heard that expounded in real life oftentimes. So, you are on the banks of the Lake of Sighs. What are you guys going to do in order to facilitate finding the stranger?
He appears in dreams.
Set up our camp.
Yep, set up camp. It's time to go to sleep.
No, we will ditch the rotten food because that will smell bad. And we don't need to attract any other beast men.
Yeah, right. We should probably bury the food.
We tried just burying everything, geez.
Well, yeah, you don't want that horrible smell everywhere. I mean, no offense, Fringe.
So the first night that you guys are at the Lake of Sighs, you are here trying to find the stranger. You're just hoping that maybe he'll show up in dreams. So all of you at some point in the night when you drift off, you get this feeling that you're not, it's one of those things where you're not sure whether you're quite dreaming or whether you're asleep or whether you're just half asleep. But you get this feeling that you're seeing this guy who just looks like a big guy covered in hair. Not fur, but hair. Like, all over. Just hair. Like, hairy face, like...
Like one of the people with the all hair all over disorder?
Yeah, yeah, like or that.
Cousin It.
Yeah.
I was gonna say Cousin It.
Facial features, but, you know. And this guy is like... You get this weird image, and you don't know why someone would do this, but you get this odd image of a guy, like, dancing from rock to rock along the banks of the lake, and he's singing. And he's doing this thing like, ung, bung, dung, fung. The stranger doesn't know how to rhyme. And he sings this song where he's making up complete nonsense words to come up with this song, and yet... The song is just annoying you to no end.
This dude is a stranger. He stays that way.
I almost asked if he was an elf, but at that point, no.
So he's singing this completely horrible off-key song, and in this sort of like dreamlike state that you all are in, he goes, "If you wish to find me, you can take my trials, and then you might see my wonderful lady who will... guide you to me and dazzle you with her beauty." And he turns around and there's a deer. And he starts like cuddling this deer in a way that makes you all very uncomfortable.
What is this trial?
Oh, we'll discuss that later. Get a good night's sleep now. Krung glung gungle pungle. Jungle, bungle, fungal jungle. And he dances off.
You can't rhyme the same word with the same word.
I'm making my own rules. So he suddenly like just disappears and like all of you spring awake at the same moment. Do you guys share this with each other?
Well, we're all awake now.
Well, I mean, since we all wake up at exactly the same time, it would probably be weird enough that we will, probably.
Idiot with bad rhymes?
Sure.
Very hairy man?
That's most of what I said. Man covers the idiot part. Bad rhyme. Yeah, okay. Bad rhyme doesn't really cover hairy. Yes, he was hairy.
So yeah, we're gonna have a very interesting, interesting time. I guess we get to go to sleep, and hopefully Vigdis finds us soon.
Yeah, you get the feeling that you know if somebody's a really good tracker, maybe he might you know be on you guys by the morning when you guys wake up again.
Oh, I don't want Vigdis on me.
So
not in the Minotaur.
What's funny is okay. Here's the thing. You all have this dream. But did Fringe actually recount that she had this dream, or did Fringe just assume this was something that she would normally see?
I mean, yeah, I don't know if she puts much stock in her dreams.
All right. So given that we are right up against our normal stop time, I think we're going to call it here on the Lake of Sighs, where you've made first contact with the stranger in your dreams. We can deal with the trials of the stranger next session. I hope you all had a good time.
Yes, we had a marvelous time committing murder.
I'd like to thank all of my players for playing. I'd like to thank anybody that watched this live, and thank you to anybody that might watch this later. And as far as I know, we'll be heading out and doing this again next week. And thank you all for watching. Thank you all for playing. And I am going to sign off now.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye, everybody.